It looks like we are live. All right. Hello, everyone. Thank you for tuning in and welcome to Guy Aitchison's Reinventing the Tattoo Community, a community for tattooers, apprentices, collectors, and the curious. We encourage you to join in these live streams and real-world events where we offer a new option for connecting with each other to better your art, develop your skill set, and be with other like-minded people. If you're new to the community, you can find us beaming out nearly every day. Here, let's make some updates here. All right, we're beaming out nearly every day. We've got several live and on-demand tattoo and art shows that have been really fun to be a part of. So right now you're currently watching Ricardo's Reinventing Drawing Group, which happens every Tuesday at 10 a.m. Eastern. I want to say thank you to everyone joining in from YouTube or Facebook, and a special thanks to those of you who are listening to our podcast. You can find our event schedule and notifications at our official RIT community at community.reinventingthetattoo.com. You can also search for and download our Reinventing the Tattoo app, found in both of the app stores, Apple, Google Play. You can also obviously join on your browser at community.reinventingthetattoo.com. All of these network shows, art jams, drawing groups, interviews, panels, webinars, all of this can be joined on demand and are stored in our library as well as our YouTube and podcast channels. There are countless tattoo and art rabbit holes, which we think are perfect for your front room of your studio or to entertain your tattoo clients. In fact, we're actually beaming out four channels 24/7. And we can, you can register for a goodie bag at that 24/7 streaming at reinventing247.com. Those have samples of shine cartridges and raw pigments. We also have several weekly shows and drawing groups that are very fun to be a part of and educational as well. Every Sunday at 1 p.m., we have the Reinventing Drawing Group with Jason Lesser. All skill levels are welcome. We encourage you to beam in and bring something you're working on, something you like critiqued, or just to come and hang out with other like-minded artists. Every Sunday evening at 9 p.m., you'll find myself, Jake Meeks, and Gabe Ripley with the Tattoo Weekly, where we kind of go over different highlights from the weeks and stuff that we find interesting. On, like I said, on Tuesdays, we also have Ricardo's Drawing Group. Wednesdays at noon is a Tattoo Now show. We've got cool guest Nick Mitchell coming up this week. And next week on August 4th, we have Mike DeVries. Thursdays at noon, we have our Tattoo Collecting podcast, which the 50th episode is coming up soon, so make sure you tune in for those. Thursday mornings, we have the Subscribers Only Exercises with Kier. All skill levels are welcome, and apprentices are encouraged to work on their fundamental skill sets. So a few ways for you to support our show are some of our upcoming pro development and on-demand shows. Now, if you have pro development stuff required for you, we definitely encourage you to check out our courses at courses.reinventingthetattoo.com. You're going to find all sorts of stuff from Andre Malcolm, BJ Betts, Bob Tyrell, and tons more, tons of hours of content. And it's very, very good to be active in that type of pro development stuff. We want to definitely say thank you to our sponsors for making this whole entire community possible for you for free. We've got the World Tattoo Events. And as you know, they're the largest, most comprehensive resource for tattoo events worldwide. They have lots of stuff updating as conventions are rescheduling like crazy. So definitely make sure you check them out. Thank you to Inkjet Stencils, where you can print stencils from your mobile or computer, saving time, hands, or your apprentice's hands. But they've got webinars and free stencils available. We've got Raw Pigments, an ink company that is tapping into the source with acrylic-free pigments that have been oppressing artists across the globe. You can find them and their upcoming event schedule at rawpigments.co. Thank you to DLize Pro, known internationally as Dermalize Pro as well. Protect your art. If you're using saran wrap, just go to dermalizepro.com to find out more about them. We also thank Gabe from Tattoo Now, which is technology for tattooers. And the founder and inspiration behind Reinventing the Tattoo, Guy Aitchison. You can find his biomech encyclopedia, DVDs, machines, paintings, and all of that at guyaitchison.com. We also have several affiliates we would like to say thank you to. Jake Meeks of the Fireside Tattoo Network. You can find them on YouTube by searching Fireside Tattoo, with countless educational videos, as well as their 3-minute series, which is super cool, quick, and easy to digest. Amy at the Apprenticeship Diaries and ecofriendlytattoosupplies.com. Now, if you've been following the Tattoo Weekly, you will have seen that on October 3rd to 6th, there is a BYOB Paradise event. And that's going to be streamed live from Jiminy Peak with a ton of special guests. The list goes on and on. Jesse Smith, Bob Tyrell, and a lot of the familiar faces from Reinventing the Tattoo. We will be in Belgium on November 12th to 14th for the Brussels Tattoo Convention. There will be seminars from Nick Baxter, Ivana, and Gabe with just a ton of awesome content happening live. We'll be meeting in an art jam, a subscriber exclusive, meetups, and general ones. All of this is happening in November. Next May, if you haven't already tried to register, May 20th to 22nd, Hell City in Columbus is happening. July 8th to 10th, the Rock River Tattoo Art Expo will be happening as well. And that'll be in Rockford, Illinois. July 20th, 29th to 31st, Tony Urbanek has his Rubber City Tattoo Invitational. And October 20th to 23rd next year, the Paradise Tattoo Gathering will officially be back. We definitely welcome positive reviews on the channels and would love for you to follow us. If you would like to host a Reinventing event kind of like this or something similar, or to sponsor our community, contact us at management@reinventingthetattoo.com. Now today, I'm going to be handing it off to Ricardo, who's got a lot of fun stuff planned. He is on location in Florida. So if you'd like to see Bruno's pretty face or Kier's pretty face, just let them know. I'm sure they'll be joining in as well. I'll be in the background to read off comments. I'll have the browser open. So if you have anything to say, just drop us a comment in the YouTube or Facebook channels, and I'll be sure to mention those to Ricardo.
Yeah, for sure.
How's it going, Ricardo?
Hey, not too bad. Doing pretty good.
Cool. Happy to see you.
Yeah, it's good to see you too. We're all pretty excited to be here this morning. It's bright and sunny down here in Florida, just like the faces in this room. we're all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed and everything like that, running through the, you know, morning kind of routines and everything. But we're all happy to be here. Let's say hello to everybody.
Hello.
Hi. Hey, Bruno, hey, Kier.
Hello.
Hi, everyone.
Yep. I've been down here since Sunday morning or early afternoon. Kier got here later that night. It was pretty fun. The craziest part about it is, and the funnest part about it is that as soon as we landed, both Kier and I both jumped in with Bruno on this collaborative charcoal piece that we've been working on. And it was pretty exciting to just touch down and jump right into it, man. So we're going to be doing a couple things. Let me show you that picture real fast first. Show you what we're doing. We did use this like large to small method that we've been talking about for the past few weeks in charcoals. And this is like a creation of Bruno and I, and then Kier has also been jumping in as well. She came in and helped us put in some of the finishing touches on it, some of that depth and everything like that you can see right here in this area on the back of the head. She notified me, and I couldn't remember the term of it, but it's called ambient occlusion. Yeah, there you go. See, I'm repeating it in my sleep and stuff like that, so I can remember how to say it. But again, like, you know, to go back to it, we talked about terms and general uses of words with art stuff and everything like that. And I've always just called it things and that stuff and those colors. So I've been doing a lot of studying, been doing a lot of, you know, truths for myself and just sitting down and reading the information and teaching these classes have helped me kind of come to grips with learning a lot of this stuff, a lot of these things and stuff.
art terms.
But yeah, so if there's nobody in the chats right now, we'll just kind of jump into part of the class. I think what we're going to do today is focus towards getting the skull project done that we've been working on for the past couple weeks. Next week, I think we're going to start jumping into some anatomy, and by the sounds of it, it might be kind of spread across the other classes too. So I'm really excited about that. And all of us kind of following along with the process as it goes. And each one of us kind of showing our own approach to it and kind of describing what it is that we go through as far as like our preparation, what it is that we use for composition, some of the value studies that we might come to explore in our drawings. So let's go ahead and start diving into this skull. I'm going to share some things with you first. If you can see this skull. Just get this all set up here. There we go. So that's what I worked on last week. I got to this point. We jumped in with Bruno, and Bruno hasn't been on the classes for a little while. He's been pretty busy working and stuff like that, doing some tattoo work, some artwork, some life work, just doing general life awesome things. So we kind of went through the process again and reworked one of the skulls with them. I don't know if you can see here, but I always talk about the geometric or the sacred tree of life. There, you can kind of see it there. As you can see, I have the squared edges of it, all these little angles that I use as far as my guides for proportions of shapes. I always start out with the general shapes, which is something that starts out really loose. I'm gonna show you some of the process here. Let me pull up and share a screen here real quick. Actually, hold on one second. But while we're waiting, I thought I'd talk to you guys about a book that I've read a while back. It's called The Story of Creation Through Sacred Geometry. An author named John McHale and another guy co-wrote it. I can't remember his name. I apologize about that. Mr. Brown, I think his last name is Brown. It's a pretty cool book. And if you get a chance, you should check it out. One of the things that he does in it is he references Galileo. And I think we all know who Galileo was. And if you don't, go ahead and fill in a little bit. He was an Italian astronomer, a physicist, an engineer. The guy is kind of like the forefather, like known as the father of science. He's known as the father of scientific method. And he's definitely, you know, called the father of observational astronomy, which is kind of where we're going to go with some of these ideas that I use in my composition. There's an energy to some of these sacred symbols that I kind of implement into my drawings and into the composition of all of my images that I create. I haven't done this forever. I've only been doing it for the past, I think, like maybe 10 or 11 years, maybe a little bit more, 13. Sometimes I can't remember how old I am, so I have to remind myself how long ago yesterday was. But let's see here. I think that was funny, right?
That was
pretty good, yeah? Yeah, all right. Yeah, all right.
The crowd makes it.
The crowd goes wild. Let's see here. I have some images that I'm going to pull up, and we're going to talk about the process through it. And Bruno sent me some pictures of these, this collaborative piece that we did. So we can kind of go through photos and see the process. Did you share them to my appropriate?
I believe it's on your, yeah, I think it's on your pad.
Okay. Okay.
Found it?
I sure did not.
I can airdrop them again.
Okay, if you don't mind, please. Thank you. So let's see, where are we going with the book? Go back to the book. In referencing life and the universe, Galileo wrote that the universe, as seen as a large book of characters written in the language of mathematics, which can only be read by those characters with knowledge of its characters, triangles, circles, and other geometrical figures. The laws of geometry are not human inventions, which is saying, he's saying that basically we think that we've created these angles and all these proportions and everything like that. But in reality, they're actually just something that we've observed and we've started applying to our known science and our known lives. So he says that they're already found, ready, made in nature, and hold a truth that is the same in all times and places and is older than the world itself. That line has always blown me away. It's always been something that resonates with me. And as I got to my older years in life, I started looking back on my actions in life beforehand and started realizing the kinds of changes and things like that that I wanted to try to make. Not only my work, but it ended up being, I guess it wouldn't be subsequently, it would be like kind of a side effect of it, was the way that it changed my life too. My artwork was changing my life. It's been pretty awesome thing to see happen, to participate in. And I guess I'm just giving a little bit more of a background of myself so we can kind of understand a little bit more of my approach as far as the way I view my perspective in art. And I've opened up this kind of doors of myself to only a few people, but here's another chance for me to take this opportunity to become a little bit more vulnerable and a little bit more open. And again, speaking to you guys on this platform and the messages that I've been getting about some of the things that we're liking about the artwork that we're doing has been a positive effect to me. So I can't thank you enough. And thank you for giving me this chance to do it with you guys. So that's what I think about that line. You guys like that one?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, I got your pictures here, Bruno. So let me see about opening this up real quick. We're going to go through some progress photos of these guys. Let me find the right ones. Nope, still not those. Those are just the ones of the work that we did last night.
Huh?
Those were just the ones of the work we did last
night. Yeah.
Okay.
You got the ones of you wanted the collab?
Yeah, the collab. Well, not the collab of the drum. Yeah, the marker. Oh, yeah, the charcoal. It's okay, dude. No worries. It's all good. Yeah, we're all friends.
Silly thing.
Should we tell them
about
the collaborator? Yeah. I thought
that was a collab.
No, yeah. It's okay. But so we're looking for these photos still so we can kind of show you the process. But what I'll do in the meantime is pull up my Procreate folders, pull up some of the images that I've gotten ready for you guys today.
All right, now they're on your way.
Okay. Thank you, Bruno. Yeah. These guys have been helping me out a ton this morning. Okay, I'll accept those. Let's see if I can send them.
Send them to
you might send them to the iPad.
All right, here we go.
Cool. We're getting through it. Got them. All right, now we're rocking. Now we're cooking with gas, man. Okay. Let's open these up and Procreate. So you guys want to come in and say a couple words, talk about some of the things that we've been doing this trip, if you don't mind?
Yeah. Let's talk it up.
Yeah. I'm just gonna make this happen. You guys want the seats?
So yeah, no, like you were saying, it was fun. You know that, like, as soon as you got here, you know, we were just about an hour away from Jason, up and up on the show at one. And so Ricardo and I were like, you know what, let's work on something together. Let's just let it flow and let's work on it while we're chatting with Jason. And so pretty much as soon as we got here, we set everything up and we got it started. You know, we just started staining the canvas and letting it loose. And what was cool, what we did, like our strategy was to, we actually had this head here as a reference for like the light and, you know, get some of these proportions right and help ourselves with this during the process. And then the rest of it, you know, just started to happen as we went along, as the stains, as the charcoal spread and created like unexpected, movements and, you know, our minds started to, you know, see the possibilities, which is one of the really cool things about working on charcoal for me, that, you know, like that always comes up, you know, the charcoal spreads and your imagination, you know, starts to see things and then you get to take it in a direction that was unexpected. And that's what we did. And we just kept on going back and forth and some fun.
So you can kind of see what he was talking about. This is pretty much when we first got here. I think this is about like an hour after I landed, which is, like I said, man, I couldn't have been more happy about it. Like, as far as the way that we just jumped into each other, said hello. With Bruno and I and Kier and Jason have all been hanging out online for about 4 months now, 5 months now. It feels longer than that, not in a bad way, in a good way, because we've learned so much from each other and it's been so invigorating and inspiring and such. But as you can see here, this is kind of what Bruno was talking about. Basically, everything's super loose. We're still using the sponge here. We're still using the sponge at this point. And what we're doing was just really just kind of laying things really loose in broad kind of areas. And we're focusing on just the primary, like just a basic shape at first. Like what he showed you with the with that styrofoam head, it was basically just like this. Just kind of masked it all off into that general silhouette shape. As we went through, we started kind of sitting back and looking at it and talking about what it was that we wanted to see. So then we started adding some of these darker areas for just some more movement and shape. And we started playing around with the proportions of the eyes, where they're gonna lay, the character and the noses and stuff, I really liked, for some reason, the biomech thing always kind of thinks, I think of like that bioorganic kind of like, I don't know, like an alien wearing a suit kind of thing. Like in the new Superman movies, I think they do that with all of Clark's people from Superman stuff. But yeah, so that was pretty fun. Let me go up to the next one.
Hey, Jason, thanks for joining.
Hey, you're very welcome. It's a pleasure.
What up? Jason, how's it going, man?
It's going well. I'm just getting my day started. I wanted to jump in and say hi to you guys.
Stampede, buddy.
Stampede. I tend to sleep in way more than these guys, so I'm just getting started now.
Yeah. Well, thanks for joining us, dude.
Yeah, it's an honor, man.
It's always a pleasure to have you here.
No, it's not. Don't lie.
Yeah. We actually tried to get you to come after all. Like, just jump on a plane. Come on. Just do it now.
Yeah, seriously. These guys wanted me to jump on a plane to hang out for like 6 hours and then get back on a plane to come back.
And you said no to that, Jason?
Right?
I'm not opposed to that.
Right? There you go, Lauren.
Thank you, Lauren.
You guys, I am also really looking forward to seeing some of this stuff. Are you going to be all attending the Paradise Gathering in October?
Yes.
Okay, cool. It'll be really cool to see some of these sketches and drawings in person there too.
Yeah, you know what? Bruno and I were actually talking about trying to get this thing more to a finished point before Kier and I head back out, back home. And I think what we're going to do is try to make some prints out of them. I think that'll be
awesome.
Pretty fun.
Yeah.
Send them to me.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, will do, man, for sure. The prints that you made for the Gettysburg show and the other artists that you knew there, man, they were killer, dude. Just exceptional quality of prints. Amazing. And this guy knows about paper.
Like, it's a little side thing that I do for, like, friends. Over quarantine, I got pretty bored and decided I wanted to start making my own prints. You know, I'd taken some printmaking classes in college, so I'm like, okay, well, all I need to do is buy the equipment. So I did. And I went out and I found someone selling this super high-end Epson, like professional quality digital print, like printer. And they gave me like $600 worth of paper with it. So I was like, oh, all right, well, I'm just going to start making prints on the side now for like friends and stuff. And I got a couple of friends that got in on it with me, and so I do some prints for a couple of different people. I'd be honored to make some prints of that. You know, I just need to know the size that you're looking for and what kind of paper you want it on.
Yeah, for sure, dude. Thank you so much. Sure. Yeah. Thank you.
This was like the second stage here, right? Like, maybe like after taking a little break and then jumping back in, you started kind of working on that backside of the head and but always going back to the styrofoam head, right? Like checking our lights, making sure the darks were in their place. But at the same time, since we were still kind of letting it flow, it kept on changing the texture, the shapes. So it kind of like morphed it morphed for a while before it landed where it is now.
Yeah, absolutely.
I was going to say, I remember Kirsten saying something about darks and lights. I'm not sure if she's awake enough right now to repeat that, but it was really enlightening when you said it, because it makes perfect sense when you think about it, right? So if you have a second, maybe you could go back over that.
Yes.
Yeah, that's the light is dark is darker than the darkest light, which just means that your mid-tone is darker than your reflected light. Yeah?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. So the area that she's talking about is basically like what we'd like to apply to the, you saw it really strongly in the styrofoam head because it was just a smooth surface. We had a strong light source on it. So it created what is known as like a, it's called a terminator edge. And what helps that, what she's talking about, the terminator edge for us was pretty much right about in this area. And that's what gives it that shape, that circular oblong kind of shape for the head. That's what gives it the form where it's got the depth to it. That's what helps give it the shape of the depth, the form. So what she's talking about is the area right underneath it. And that's called, that's, that comes from like a reflected kind of light from a surface that you might not see that's outside of the frame of reference. Would you say that that's pretty much accurate?
Yeah, and I remember we were talking over breakfast yesterday about how like there's, it just gives everything more form, like it's needed form. And it really, it gives the example of like the difference between the terminator and the reflected light. And there's no such thing as the terminator edge without reflected light in it. So you kind of have to apply it, especially in tattooing, for it to give it that like 3D effect, like how you're saying you can like go in and grab it kind of thing. And I said that that comes from the reflected light mostly. So it's a very important role to play. Everybody should put that in there.
Absolutely. I agree. It really kicks it up. It really kicks it up. And that's where we started applying some of these cast shadows and such like that at that point. I started getting into some of the details and everything like that. All the while, we were still using that flat and pointed styrofoam brush. We were not really implementing the use of the charcoal pencil at this time, except for in some smaller spots where I wanted to start catching some of the right proportions, which you can kind of see in these areas here. Get another one. You can kind of see them right here. Where I started using it. You can tell, you can really tell because you can see the sketch marks. And that's just the tip of the pencil dragging or stumbling, as I like to say, across the surface of the paper. That's just to give it a little bit more focus and a little bit more attention to where our focal points are gonna be and where our strongest light sources are gonna apply and the cast shadows that will kind of reflect that light and dark duality. I like the way I said that just now. so here's more of
very eloquently product. Put.
Thank you very much.
Very
I've practicing. I've been practicing. So here's more of a finished kind of product. We're still going to be working on it today. We have a couple different projects going on. We're going to be doing a collaborative tattoo. Our focus was definitely a collaborative tattoo and a piece of art. While we're together, for sure, to take, you know, these few moments that we have together and make the most out of it. So what we're gonna do today, last night we went ahead and applied a fixative to it, which is gonna create, like when Procreate, what you can do is just create another layer for any kind of things that you might be wanting to achieve as far as opacity kind of layers or any kind of practice layers or anything like that. So what the fixative is going to do to it is kind of create this new barrier, a new layer for the actual image itself. So we'll be able to go through and add more darks to this and add more actual like white highlights and such, which I think we discussed last night in Guy Etchison's class, is that we're going to be practicing with, we're going to kind of experiment a little bit. I think this is a multimedia paper. So we might be able to get away with using some acrylics and such on it after the fixative has been put on it. But Jason was mentioning last night that we might want to be careful with that. Actually, Guy and Jason were both saying that it might tear through the paper. So I know that I've applied it before with a lot of fixative layers on like newspaper media. But so we're going to really kind of go in and be really careful and just start applying some spots, like some small spots here and there.
Be very, very gentle.
Yeah.
The next goal is pretty much going to be like maximizing the darker areas and the lighter areas, basically, right? Kind of really boosting up that contrast wherever it goes and creating those really dark areas, especially after it's sealed, you know, it should concentrate a little bit more darkness, a little bit easier.
Yep.
And yeah, my friend, Roberto Talavera, he does a lot of really awesome charcoal work. He tends to use what Jason was recommending. Like he'll use the pastel, the white pastel a lot, and the chalk. Those are his two like go-to tools for like highlights and finishing the job.
That's awesome. So other artists feel the same way.
Yeah.
That's good.
But yeah, I mean, there's many ways, many different ways to do it.
There's a will, there's a way.
That's it.
This is the way.
And experimenting is always a good investment, you know.
Do or do not. There is no
try. There is no try.
There is no try.
That's it.
Bunch of nerds.
Hey, man.
Do or do not.
This is the way.
This is the way. So you can see where we really started focusing on after like our breakfast conversation and everything like that, and us sitting around staring at the picture. We went to the beach yesterday, which is awesome. And we ended up drawing while we were there too. I love it being around a group of people like this that are into drawing and tattooing and talking about art and talking about how it reflects on life and et cetera, et cetera. As much as I do, as much as I want to. It's great because all we did was talk about all these other things that kind of influence our other areas of life. And we came back and reapproached this thing and really started laying in. Bruno killed it back here with these like real subtle kind of shapes that are very complementary to all this texture, where these areas are so smooth and such big open spots for the light to really play on the edges of that dark, and how the tonal value changes from this area to back here, right? In this area versus this right here. It's really cool how he like saw that and he implemented it. And with Kier helping us talking about the ambient inclusion, it really just bumped everything up. We were able to kind of come in with this cast shadow and this larger shape. I was trying to mirror what Bruno did on the opposite side of the image to kind of create that balance where it unified them together. And if you see it, what it does is it really helps create this line of sight that kind of curves the whole image. So those are the kind of things that I try to pay attention to whenever I'm doing anything, any projects, any images, any sort of art, any sort of life. How do they all relate to each other? But yeah, do you guys have anything else you want to add about this piece?
It feels like it could go on forever.
Yeah.
And you just keep adding texture and texture and texture and texture and rendering a texture.
Right, right.
Forever.
Like when it's done, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
But it's really fun, and instead, not to say it's a bad way, because texture, I feel like I just started getting into the texture layer of things.
Mm-hmm.
But like once you start getting a fluidity of what the texture that you're looking for, mm-hmm. like it's so much fun just making it. You just go and you stumble around, you make different textures, different high points, low points. It's fun.
So now
I did have a couple of questions. I noticed that you used your super dark black very, very sparingly, right?
Yes.
Are you planning on going back in and adding more areas of super dark? Or are you planning on keeping let's say the top 60% of values, are you keeping those at the tone that they're currently at, but then pushing that contrast even further when you get into those white highlights?
Yeah, that's most likely where we're headed once we jump back in, like to maximize those darker tones along with the lightest, the brightest highlights, right? Because since it's charcoal, you know, the darks tend to kind of, they don't hold as well. And so I think that now after like putting that sealer on it and going back in, it's going to concentrate the charcoal a little bit better and create those darker areas. Like for example, below the chin, like in that that area where the neck is.
Here?
Yeah, like that whole area is definitely gonna become darker. And I'm guessing, right, we're gonna kind of there's gonna be some kind of gradation towards the top, you know, where it gets a little bit lighter. But this whole left area on the side of the head, I think for sure, like you said, right, like there's a lot of room for more darkness to kind of help things pop.
I think you're right. And I think especially if it came from the outside and going towards these other dark areas of the face, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I think that would help out quite a bit, like, and create that like depth and atmosphere too.
Yeah, because there is very few spots where there's like actual dark, like 100%.
Right. Like here, maybe.
And that's where we got.
So one thing that I, a little trick that I picked up along the way, Ricardo, you're in Procreate, right?
Yes, sir.
So I want you to do something for me.
Okay.
I want you to go into your gallery.
Okay.
And I want you to duplicate that document.
Okay. So I'll just go select this one, duplicate. All right.
Cool. And go into the new one. This way we don't mess up anything that might be happening.
Okay.
Go to all of your layers.
Well, there's going to be a lot of them.
Smush them all together, flatten the image.
Okay, is there a way to do it all at once?
Take your two fingers and make like the little crab pinchy motion.
Oh, on the layers, I think.
And just start pinching them together.
Okay.
Like a little crab.
Like, and you can get groups of them too. So feel free to grab like
a bunch of them. Look at all this stuff we're learning today, man.
Yes.
It's awesome. All right, okay. Cool.
So that's our image.
This guy. Okay.
Now take that layer and zoom in so it fills the whole canvas. Good. Stop. Now go up to your adjustments menu. Go down to Gaussian blur.
Oh, yes. I love this.
Select
one.
Layer.
Mm-hmm.
And bring it all the way up. Okay, so right there, yeah. I'm looking at maybe a 3 or a 4 on the value scale.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, as far as like the overall composition goes, I don't really see too much contrast in super dark and super light. I know it's still a work in progress, which is,
that's a really good point.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I'm not seeing too much super dark and super light. I see a lot of really subtle mid-tone values.
Yeah, you're right.
And it's just some, like, this is like a little trick that I've picked up along the road less traveled that really helps me determine, do I really have a full value range of contrast?
Yeah. Which is great, because this is exactly what you and I had talked about when you first visited me. And this is exactly what it is that I implement into like my study of like the larger sizes of shapes to the smaller sizes of shapes, right?
Right.
So I totally agree with you. You can see it clearly, like clear as a bell. Like the cool part about that is that, like, you know, Jason, thank you for showing us how the step-by-step process and then pointing these keynotes out. I appreciate you so much. Because you can definitely see it down here in like the mouth area for sure. You know what I mean? There's not a lot of separation between that textural value into that glass mask over her face,
right?
Kind of thing. You know what I mean? So you can definitely see that. So there needs to be some more separation and value there for sure. And you can also see it like on the face looks pretty good. The top portion of the face.
Right. I think that's fine. I think the neck area, that background.
Yep, you got it.
I think those are
going to
be the two spots you really want to focus on the most.
Yeah, I think you might be right. I think this area, like back here, can definitely use some for sure.
Yeah.
You got
to have something back there to make those lighter shadow values on the back part of the cranium.
Yeah.
You really need something there to really help bring that out.
Yep. Yeah, you can tell. Yeah, right away. Yeah, that's cool, man. I don't know where I was going with that. But I think the cool part that I like about this, Jason, is that like we just kind of demonstrated the fact that there is like
there's always a matter of perspective when it comes into play with our design.
Right.
Our overall composition and everything like that. Like, and that's what kind of what we've been talking about a lot lately is just that matter of perspective. You know, like, how do we change? How do we get out of our own element? How do we get out of our own eyeballs and our own involved life as far as our past actions, our past experiences and stuff like that, and kind of implement a new way of looking at things, you know? And personally, I think that a lot of that affects exactly what it is that we were just demonstrating right now, like how to step out of that element and give yourself a fresh kind of pair of eyes to
approach it. Absolutely. I think it also depends ultimately on your intention, right? Because intention is like the major motivating factor behind most works of art. With the right intention, it doesn't really matter if your value contrast is at a full value range or not. Maybe your intention is to explore the media. Maybe your intention is to focus on large shapes, large gradients. In that case, you're not really worried about contrast or value. You're not really worried about, you know, the composition so much, you know, so I think a lot of it also ends up coming down to what is your intention for the piece? What is its purpose?
Yep. I agree with you. The overall goal. I couldn't relate to you any more than I do right now, man. This is really resonating with me because I was wondering what it was that exactly what details, you know, talk about a lot of this stuff today. And I think I'm so glad that you jumped on. You're bringing these things up because it's exactly what I was thinking about showing, like correlations between these principles of art and the way they apply to our life and everything like that too.
Hey, Ricardo, before you jump in on that, I want to say thank you to everybody watching on YouTube, Jerry, Atomic Ink Jackson 47, Rod, and everyone else. Thank you for joining.
Yeah, thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
So you're talking about your intention, right?
Right.
As far as your overall goal, the point of it is what you're saying is to kind of a plan of attack, or like, what is it? What is my general? What's my first idea? What's the inspiration behind this image? And what do I need to do to implement that as far as the overall affected image? Like, how am I going to make it look cohesively finished? What steps do I need to take in order for that to happen? And how do I apply them, right?
Well, I also, that's part of what I was saying. I was also looking at, what are you trying to get out of it? What is the end goal?
Yeah.
What are you trying to achieve?
Right.
You know, because without knowing what you're trying to achieve, it's going to make the whole journey of getting to that point, you know, quite a bit longer.
Yes.
One of the goals, right? Like, what I think that part of the intention in this particular project was to actually, well, there were like multiple, I guess, intentions in the sense that one of them was to stay loose and to see what happens, right? And what starts to develop. Then the other intention, I think, without us even thinking about it, because these are great questions, what we're talking about right now, I think it's very important to take into consideration. I completely agree. And I think that now that you know, I try to answer that question, it seems like, I think part of our intention was to also like maximize on some of the things that we've been, you know, learning as far as like maximizing contrast, making sure the shapes have, you know, like that the light work is working well, that, you know, everything is in, like that things aren't, you know, too defined where they're not supposed to be, like kind of maximizing on all the tricks. And that combined with, you know, with, I guess, the creative mind in the moment, kind of like just seeing what happens, right? Like, I guess our intention was just to make something cool in this particular case, right? See how cool we can make something working together. I don't know. What do you think about that?
Which is totally cool. Like, I love stuff like that. I think that is the purest form of intention, is to say, I don't know, there's no real intention. Let's just see what comes out. right? That is pure creativity.
Uh-huh.
You know, and I personally find that the most noble of intentions.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I would agree with that for sure.
I apologize for throwing you off your track, Ricardo. I do.
No, it's okay, because I think that's the point that you're trying to make, which is I agree with you completely though, man. And I think that's we're all talking about the same thing, the application. First of all, you have to start out with your intent, like you said, the care and what it is that you're doing. Absolutely. Secondly, you have to figure out how to know how to do these things. And a lot of that is through trial and error. A lot of that is through listening to other people talking, speaking to you, teaching you, getting out of your own way in order for that to be able to be fully capable of happening. And that's two people that with the intent already of spreading this knowledge, of spreading this care that they've already developed over their years of knowledge, and you being able to accept it. There's a resonating effect there. And I think that it's incredible. And I think that translates through our art for sure. And like, you know, the perception of life is as much of an illusion as our artwork can be an illusion to people. We take a 2D object and we make it into, you know, a three-dimensional form for people to believe that they're seeing this object that they can relate to, a skull, a face, a hand, you know, anything, a bird, whatever it is that you want to tattoo, whatever it is that you want to draw. We've created that illusion with a lot of these things behind the perception of that image. So, man, like, oh my God.
Well, you know, it's a really interesting proposal, you know what I mean, question, like, to bring up, because I think that if we would have added that to our intentions, like, to figure out beyond, like, you know, being loose and, you know, having fun, maybe questioning a little bit more, right? Like, what is our intention other than that? Like, do we have more than just having fun? Maybe that would have added to, you know, to the arsenal, you know, that question itself. I think it's really important that you brought that up, because I think that should be always in the creator's mind, I think.
Absolutely. You know, it's something that I found myself, you know, asking myself, because I don't really interact with too many people outside of you guys, for a very legitimate reason, because, you know, I don't like people. No, I'm joking. I love it. But it's something I found myself asking. Like, I would stand back and I would look at a finished painting that I had just finished, and I would ask myself right off the bat, did I accomplish what I set out to accomplish? Right? Whether it was a study in line and form or value or contrast or composition, or maybe I was trying to play around with like a new medium. You know, I would always set out with a goal, no matter what the work of art I was creating was. Maybe it was to illustrate light or practice metallic shapes and reflections. Who knows, right? But I set out with a specific goal and purpose in mind. And I would step back without really looking at the work as a whole, and I would say, did I accomplish what I tried to accomplish? Did I focus on that, and did I nail it? You know, yeah. Is this going to satisfy whatever it was I was trying to say? And, right. You know, a lot of times you get lost and you get wrapped up in the work that you create, you know,
yes.
You get, you know, maybe what you guys were drawing was a focus on value, and contrast over form,
yes.
Or composition, right? In which case that's where I would focus more on the contrast. But since that was kind of secondary and you wanted to focus more on just creativity and creating, then whether or not it has a full value range of contrast is kind of irrelevant, right? Because you set out to accomplish creating a work of art, and you've done that.
That's an awesome way to put it, man. You're talking about your primary, secondary, and tertiary kind of like effects.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Think of it like color.
Yeah. Yeah, color for sure. Let's think about it like
no teal, Kira.
Yeah.
Oh, dang.
Yeah.
We're make your clear, use of teal.
Teal flag for her to wave around all the time.
Speaking of color and like a lot of these things that I apply, I've always talked about triangles with you guys. You know what I mean? I've always talked about triangles, all this stuff. Well, you know, it's like Kira had explained in her fundamentals class, it's the basis shape of the Fibonacci sequence, as far as the mathematical equation goes. The triangles are all in spirals, they're all in circular shapes. And we always joked around about how Ricky can find triangles in a circle, no matter what, right? Well, turns out to be true whenever I was laughing about it. And I was like, yep. And I think you knew it too. That was the best part about the joke, is that you already knew it. And I was like, yeah, I can find them. You're like, I know. So that was one of the coolest parts about it, man. You know what I mean? So, but there's a resonating energy to that as far as the Fibonacci sequence goes. There's a resonating energy to all of these fundamental shapes in the sacred geometry that I use to implement my compositions and my proportions and my approach to my artwork. You know what I mean? And it resonates. It resonates through. If you have a positive energy as the underlying structure of any illusion that you're creating for yourself or for other people to see, then that will come through as far as the translation goes. And I'm pretty excited about that. I get pretty excited about it. I get pretty jazzed about it. Even in this color wheel, you can kind of see how it all emanates from the center point and it kind of branches out. Let me get this guy here. Center point. Man, where the heck is all my pick? There we go. Man, dude, come on. Oh yeah, I gotta put it above everything else. That's right.
Wrong layer.
There we go. And as far as the Fibonacci sequence goes, it always starts from the beginning point, right? I'm not even going to worry about that layer anymore. I'm just going to start a new one right here. There we go. Starts from an origins point. And you can see how the spiral touches everything around it. From its point of nothing to its point of everything. And infinite possibilities.
Wu-wei.
It encompasses everything. And we are, as artists and as creators and as people that can, as all of us as humans, we can understand that we are the origin point of ourself, and that we can emanate whatever energy that we want to.
Nice.
So not only does it always spiral out and touch everything that we come into contact with, we can also change the direction of it too. At any point of our life, we can change everything that we are, everything that we think we are. Like in our drawings, like in the images that we create every day, we make our reality real by our thoughts and our care, secondly, our thoughts, and then our application. Like Jason was just talking about the fundamentals of your approach.
Ricardo?
Yes, sir.
So I have a question for you. Can you leave that back up for a second?
Yeah. The whole thing? Like what I just drew with the spiral?
Yeah.
Okay.
So based on what you were just talking about, right? And how we are, you know, the center of that.
Yes.
Does that mean that my parents were lying to me when I used to think that I was the center of the world?
Yes.
So everything does revolve around me.
As far as yes, exactly.
Okay. I just wanted to clarify that. Thank you for illustrating that.
You're welcome, man. Then you can show them the scientific proof to it too now. You know what I mean?
It's like, yeah, I was right.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, that's the funny part about it is because, like, as far as from behind our perception, we are the center of everything. But once we realize that we're truly not the center of our known existence, and that's when we become part of something bigger. And you put positivity into that and you try to become that positive beacon, that positive point, spreading knowledge, spreading love. And I know, you know, a lot of people will say, oh, it's all about love. I agree too, but I think it's more about care. Well, the intent of love is what it's supposed to be. Yeah. And like, that's what we do when we create. You know, a lot of times we, as artists, get frustrated. We start beating ourselves up all the time. We're always approaching these images, like these ideas of ourself. Oh, I'm not good enough. Oh, why didn't I do better on that tattoo? Oh man, why can't I just nail this image the way that I want to make it? And we have all this self-defeating, self-deprecating kind of ideas that float around in our head. And instead of focusing and dwelling on that, we have to acknowledge the fact that it's real and then turn it around and let us know, let ourselves know that that's the reality that we're creating whenever we think that all the time. When we think that all the time, we manifest it to be true, because like art, it is a creation of ourselves. So those are my general approaches with my artwork and my understanding of these terms and things like that, that I'm coming to, well, the terms with. So like, it's fun. It's been a fun process. It's been a fun part of my life. And like me being on the forum and stuff like that has been just, oh man, amazing timing. As far as my acknowledgement of us running into each other, not out of chance, not out of coincidence, but there's a reason for it. And I'm glad all you guys that are watching right now, wherever it is you're watching from, are doing the same thing. And I encourage you to try to jump in on these classes. The Zoom is open to the public. It's good for us to all share our thoughts, even if it's contrary to what I'm saying, especially if it's contrary to what I'm saying. I would love for you to jump in so we can talk about it. And then find out what it is that your approach is and see if I can learn something from you.
Yeah.
And here is the sacred tree of life that I always go from, that I always use as my fundamental composition structure map, if you will. And here's some points of intersecting lines. And I'm always talking about intersecting angles because they're in everything. They're in all composition of artwork. One of these days, it'd be nice to just have a class where we just dissect classic paintings, modern paintings, even some of the abstract art that you'll see has a lot of these underlying composition lines. And like our lives are, we always move. Hopefully you're moving in a forward direction, some kind of linear path, even though I think it's more circular than anything. We intersect at some points. And it depends on where you're at in your journey, on what state of mind you're in, that will be that intersecting point of two people's actions. So hopefully we have the right way of thinking about things, the right concepts, the right approach to ourselves in order to appreciate this moment and experience it in our own reality. So, another triangle. There it is again. And also, it's very, what's the right word, uterus, right? It's very like kind of resemblance of a uterus, the birth of life. You know?
Oh, yes, that's the question.
Yeah. And then, so with that being said, let's see. Now let's go into the way I apply it to some of my composition. Hopefully you guys can see this. Whenever I approach faces, skulls, etc., this shape was intended to lay over, I think, from my understandings and my readings, it was supposed to be laid over the proportions of a human. But I've learned that I can apply it to different portions of the body as well as not just the overall shape of the body, and still be able to find the correct proportions as far as the relative shapes to each other within that silhouette. And I say silhouette because it doesn't matter, man, woman, whatever your preferences, whatever you want to identify as, it doesn't matter. Just that general silhouette of what we recognize as a human being. But I think it's great. I think it's good to have that energy that we put behind our intentions, like Jason's talking about, and our approaches to get there is as old and older than time itself. You know, Leonardo da Vinci was studying this back in his time too. And you can see that his breakdown of the flower of life, the seed of life, where it starts, the origin point. Let me go around here. Where's it at? I can't find it. Sorry, I have a lot of notes. I kind of grabbed some stuff that I've been sitting on and compiled it pretty quickly today. So I apologize about not being a little bit more organized. But again, here's their origins point. And you can see how he's developed into that idea of from smaller to larger. And also, again, that Fibonacci sequence that starts from one origin point. You can also see the intersecting lines that he's broken it down into. Those intersecting points of energy and where they relate into this circular shape that we don't pay attention to as being straight, linear triangles.
Thank you.
Gesundheit.
Thank you.
So.
Anybody recognize that symbol? Hazmat radioactive symbol. It's interesting, isn't it? Mm. All right, and then so let's keep fucking moving on. Let's see, where does everything else go? I think that was about it. That's all that I had to prepare. Here's the Fibonacci. There it is. You can see his study, Leonardo's study in the human body, like I was talking about a little bit ago. Here's a Vitruvian man. And its proportions to itself. And I don't know if you guys can recognize this right off the first sight here, but let me point it out. I'm sure it's pretty obvious. But here is what we would call, let's go with another green one. Let's go with red. It's okay. You guys recognize this shape after I start adding some little lines to it. Anybody? Bueller? Bueller?
Fry.
That would be the DNA sequence.
I'll just try it in, you guys.
What's
double
that?
Helix, double helix.
You got it. Exactly. our creation is in this geometry.
Wow, interesting.
We're tied to this more than we know. We're tied to this more than we were taught. We're tied to this more than we think about. It's older than anything that we can perceive. And I think that that alone is worth the investment in studying how this can be beneficial, not only to our lives, but to our fundamentals in our arsenal with art and creating images. But again, it's up to you. And you can take this and do with it what you will. But I would hope that we could all sit down and have a conversation about it one day. And maybe we can start applying these to some of our artworks without the prior knowledge to it. And we can start sharing it on the forum or on YouTube or on Facebook or Instagram, whatever your favorite social media vehicle is. And then we can kind of go from there. Is it the way I said vehicle or the fact that I used vehicle?
Just like how you used vehicle.
It's think about the definition of it. So again, yeah. So that's pretty much that. I don't think I have too much else to say about it or show about it right now. But there's a general application for one of the skulls that I did a long time ago too. And it's not like I'm using this to create the skull image. It's just the way that I recognize my proportions. It's the way that I recognize this old information, the sacred information in our and what we recognize as a skull, because it's not really a skull. It's just the illusion of a skull. So that's that. Let me see if I can unshare myself now. Not sure. There we go. So that was that. I think you guys want to talk about anything? You want to add to any of that?
No, I think it's great information. It's a lot of what I said in my class, my golden ratio class, and all around revolves around the same principle. So I think that's fantastic.
Yeah.
How about it? I'm still enlightened by the information. It's like magic almost.
What would you say about your artwork since you've started like kind of recognizing a lot of this stuff?
things don't seem so hard anymore.
Yeah, what do you mean by hard?
Well, I took a class with Marshall Vandruff on learning composition because I had such a tough time coming up with a pleasing composition. And then it wasn't until I actually started learning triangles and you were telling me about these magnificent triangles that I was understanding that it wasn't so much the subject matter that I was picking, it was where I was placing everything as elements mm-hmm. and how they need to be pleasing to the mind. And since being awakened to this concept, it's a lot easier to place things where they are pleasing because you just think about that simple rule of golden ratio and you know, triangles, stars, pleasing shapes in that matter, and placing your composition in that way. And it's not as difficult anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
Especially yeah. in tattooing.
It really seems to be, you know what it reminds me of a lot? When we did the wave class with Malcolm, and it was an awesome class. I learned so much on that one. And he brought up, I think it was Guy that asked the question, right? Like, how do you, you know, make sure that when you're making these waves that they don't kind of run into each other and that they're like, you know, placed in the composition in a way that, you know, that you know, they're in like the right place. There's harmony considering how much waves there's going to be. And he mentioned that, you know, according to what he's been reading on like Japanese, traditional Japanese way of making it, they would use like the scales, you know, like the dragon scales to measure, right, where you can place the waves without them, you know, creating conflict among each other, like creating a clutter, right? And so that made a lot of sense. And this theory of, you know, like the triangles, formations and the stars as a guide, you know, to kind of make sure that you're distributing, you know, the elements in your composition in a way where it's going to end up, where they're not going to, where there's not going to be conflict between them and where it's going to flow, right? And so the other day in Kier's class, we were looking into the triangles and the star, and I had done a quick little sketch of a candle with smoke and, you know, just kind of going intuitively with the flow. And then I put the star over it. And as soon as I did, I realized that if I moved the smoke a little bit to this side to kind of fit the formation of the star, like let me see what happens. And immediately after I did, and I took the star out, there was way more harmony in that smoke just because it aligned with the star. So like Kier says, you know, that way it can make things easier because you have this tool where you can like double check if things are laid out in a harmonious way, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, yeah. And I'm not gonna lie, like when Ricardo first started telling me about these triangles and like just stars and all these great geometric things, it took me a while to like even start implementing them because I was having trouble with like drawing snakes or whatever. He's like, just put a star over it. And I was like, all right, guy. I'll put a star over it. And even then it took still like a couple more weeks before I was like, well, wait a minute. I think he's on to something.
By golly.
By golly, he might actually know what this is. This isn't just triangles. It's all its own geometric form and fluidity. It's the formula for fluidity, which is like 95% of tattoo art. And yeah. It's design factors. So it's great. Great information. Good job. 10-10.
Yeah, all right. Sweet. That's fucking awesome. That's fucking radical, man.
It's my Yelp rating for you, bro.
I got a good Yelp rating. I don't know if I have Yelp ratings or not. Is that of my person or is that of the information?
Just 10-10. We'll listen to you again.
Oh, okay, cool. You'll play it back.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so yeah, I don't really know where else to go from here. I guess we could
like there, for example.
Let's see.
Like how everything lines up right there with something pre-designed by nature, like a skull. Mm-hmm. And it works when you put track.
And it's important to say that in art, all we're doing is replicating what's already reality for us. So we obviously have to take these geometric shapes into account when creating our composition, which is what you show greatly.
Well, yeah, thank you very much, Kira. I appreciate that. And Bruno, thank you guys for the kind words, man.
Yeah, buddy.
Well, that's the cool part about it. What I recognize about it is that it's already in life as it is. You know what I mean? It's already in our everyday lives. It's already in us too. So how does it not make sense to kind of like, if we're recreating what we perceive as a skull, then why not use those same elements that are already in this existing form to help us create it on the 2D surface? So that's kind of where I'm coming from with
that. The closer that you get to imitating nature, the better chance you have of having someone find your art pleasant to the eye.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Because we're designed, you know, to be attracted to nature, the patterns in nature. And so when you use that in your art, then you're, you know, giving yourself an edge. Well, in a way, art is really all about, you know, finding a way to use nature's laws, right? Like to recreate something that is believable enough because it's made through the same laws that make real things.
Exactly, dude. That's very well said, Bruno, because that's the entirety of what it is that we're trying to talk about today, man. You nailed it. Like our recognition of the nature around us, you know, and how we perceive it. But the craziest part, the most beautiful part to me about it is that each person that views that image is going to have their own perception of it based off their past experiences and their prior experiences and their current experiences, and hopefully not their future experiences, because you're not really living in any kind of moment other than the future or past, if that's the case. So hopefully you can be present enough to accept it for what it is, or what you might want to hear that it's supposed to be, instead of putting your own, that can be hopefully not a biased opinion on it or perception on it. So,
hey guys, I gotta duck out.
Okay, Jason.
It was a pleasure joining you today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, man. It's always a pleasure, Jason.
Great seeing you, buddy.
Likewise. You guys take care. Have a wonderful day.
Bye. Take it easy, man.
Jason is such a rad dude.
Jason's out.
We were talking about it over this past weekend, Jason, Bruno, Kier, and I, about how actually Jason was kind of like the, you know, the glue that kind of brought us all four of us together.
The ringleader.
Yeah, so it's pretty neat. We like all felt the same way when we were talking about it this past weekend. It's great. He's a rad dude. If you guys ever have any questions about anything like that, make sure and join him Sundays at, 1 p.m.?
Yep.
Sundays at 1 p.m. Eastern time. A ton of knowledge in that dude's head. Tons of knowledge.
Ridiculous.
Like, seriously, just incredibly insane how beautiful his mind is. So yeah, so that's about it. Lauren, if you're there.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, thank you so much. I hate to be a bother. I was wondering if you could play that link that I sent you. I'm gonna grab a couple charcoal pencils and stuff like that. If you can do that while I do.
Pull it up.
Okay, thank you so much. Lauren's also been such a huge help.
Raw Pigments.
And she represents Raw Pigments. Yep, I couldn't be happier to be a part of that in some way or form. And thank you, Lauren, for all your help and assistance.
As you're saying that, I'm questioning which reference the YouTube link.
Yes, it should be in the outline that I sent you today.
Yeah, definitely. I will just give me 1 minute and I'll get it.
Okay, awesome. Thank you. The charcoal pencils.
Oh, they're right here. Look. Oh, cool. I mean, I brought everything right there.
Nice. Right here. Thank you so much.
Rules.
I don't think we can hear it, but I think people.
Nope.
Can hear
I will. I just have the sound muted just because I am watching the comments. So 1 second.
No problem.
Just give me 1 minute, and I'll get it.
Okay. Awesome. No, thank you. I don't know if you guys have seen this or not. It's pretty bitchy.
If the world that we are forced to accept is false and nothing is true, then everything is possible.
On the way to discovering what we love, we will find everything we hate, everything that blocks our path to what we desire.
Comfort will never be comfortable for those who seek what is not on the market.
A systematic questioning of the idea of happiness.
We'll cut the vocal cords of every empowered speaker. We'll yank the social symbols through the looking glass. We'll devalue society's currency.
To confront the familiar.
Society is a fraud so complete and venal that it demands to be destroyed beyond the power of memory to recall its existence.
Where there is fire, we will carry gasoline.
To interrupt the continuum of everyday experience and all the normal expectations that go with it.
To live as if something actually depended on one's actions.
To rupture the spell of the ideology of a commodified consumer society so that our repressed desires of a more authentic nature can come forward.
To demonstrate the contrast between what life presently is and what it could be.
To immerse ourselves in the oblivion of action to know we're making it happen.
It will be an intensity never before known in everyday life to exchange love and hate, life and death, terror and redemption, repulsions and attractions.
Affirmation of freedom so reckless and unqualified that it amounts to a total denial of every kind of restraint and limitation.
It's one of the best parts.
Hey, old man, what you doing up there?
I'm not sure.
You need any help getting down, sir?
I don't think so.
Stupid bastard.
No worse than us. He's all action and no theory. We're all theory and no action.
Oh, man, I love it.
Very cool.
Yeah, thank you. That movie, again, you know, I pull a lot of media clips off of it. And it's called Waking Life. If you guys get a chance to, I highly suggest it. It doesn't age. That movie, I think, is from the early 2000s, and it's still just as good now as it was then. But I really liked that clip, especially for today, because we've been talking a lot about a lot of theoretical components, about a lot of possibles in our lives and our art and our approaches, as far as like the way they merge together, in my opinion. But the application is actually what is the most important part. We can have all the knowledge in the world, all the experiences in the world, but if we don't do anything with it, then that's the truest, what is the right way to say it? Like, sad thing that could happen in our life.
Traumatic?
Tragedy. That's the truest tragedy. That's the word that I was looking for. So, yeah. So that's up to you guys. You know what I mean? Everybody that's watching, everybody that watches this at some point in time, it's up to you guys to do with it what you will. And hopefully we can all experience the same kind of positive thing out of it together. And then talk about it. Gosh, dang it. Be good to have everybody jump in, say what's up. But if you're watching and you're working and stuff like that, thank you guys for tuning in. Today has been an awesome, awesome thing. It's been so radical.
We do have some people commenting. Thank you for putting this together. Great information, Jason, too, from before. From my perspective, I want to say thank you to everybody that's continued to watch as well.
Thank you, Lauren.
I do have a comment from Atomic Injections 47 saying, so I know you use the triangles a lot. I kind of feel like I see things in more of a cylinder and circles framework. Y'all are forking awesome. Thank you for all of your help.
You're welcome. Thanks for pointing that out, man. The cylinders, it's cool that you pointed out the cylinders because you're already thinking in terms of form, which is exactly what I was trying to provide with this drawing large to small kind of approach to it, is the shapes are the fundamental of the form. So if, and once you start adding these values, which is the large to small approach with a sponge brush and looser bristle brush, it applies that value to it as you are finding your shapes and your proportions. So you're kind of eliminating that and you're kind of helping yourself with that shape to form process, all in that application of finding your proportions. So it's really cool that you're already thinking in the terms of form, because as you know, we all know, you take two oblong little circles, like a football kind of shape, put one on the top, put one on the bottom, draw a straight line, and you almost have a cylinder right away, just with contour lines. So good on you, man. Thank you for commenting. Thank you for letting us know about that. It'd be nice to see some work from you too. If you want to send us a couple things, we can kind of discuss it, find out more about your approach. So right now what I'm doing is I'm going through my my charcoal pencil. It's got a fairly sharp edge on it.
And I'm just trying to apply my sharper edges to kind of bring things a little bit more into focus out of that looser background. And I think hopefully it's translating well over the screen that you can see where it's already kind of coming into focus a little bit more. And this stuff is staying a little bit further back, so on this side of the face. I really like to concentrate on the eye and the nose being the focal point. And a lot of that has to do with these little kind of cracks that we might put in the off of the nose that come up into that bridge of the nose area. The reference that I used for the skull had this weird little deviation where some of the bone that usually makes this lower, this nasal cavity a little bit lower, it was kind of broken off, so it kind of came up a little bit higher. So it might look kind of a little off, but in the reference, I'm just kind of replicating what I see in the reference right now. Instead of kind of taking my own liberties with it and doing something crazy and like morphing it out or, you know, adding a rose to it or something like that, which is always fun to see. But we'd like to try to get this a little bit closer to being finished today. If you guys are following along, it'd be awesome to be able to finish it up a little bit closer to today or sometime in the next few days before next Tuesday. Because I think what we're gonna be doing, like I said earlier, is starting to apply some anatomy ideas and concepts to our drawing classes across the platform, which would be awesome. So you can see I'm taking that straight soft value over here to the left, so my left side of the face. And applying some edges to it. And it's already given it that shape, that concept of that perception of teeth and the edge of the jawbone here. Again, I'm always holding my pencil at the back end of the length of the pencil, and I'm always sitting about an arm's length away from it. That way I can kind of take in the whole image as these areas are starting to relate to itself. This is an easy way to kind of pay attention and make sure you're maintaining your idea of focal points. Make this area in this like gap between the teeth a little bit darker. Making a little rounder shape on the teeth that are gonna be down at the bottom jaw. The curved kind of shape. This is where a lot of the nuances of these edges come into play. There's a lot where a lot of like what might appear just as a simple curve actually might have some little deviations in it, like some little opposite end C curves that really help shape those divots that you can later add with some soft tonal values to kind of give it that shape or that form, I'm sorry, form of depth. When it comes to, again, light and dark relations, right? Yeah, I used to be so afraid of like all those turns, man. I still mess them up from time to time because I'm still learning, but like I used to be so like just not even wanting to approach it. And I didn't want to talk to anybody about my artwork because I had no real idea. And I was apparently too lazy to just pick up my phone and type in, what does this mean? What does this mean? And it's pretty funny how it took so long to do it, but I think now is the right time for me though. But either way, you guys can do it too, man. And now I feel like I'm still kind of like, not sure sometimes if I'm saying it right, but it's okay though.
Gabe just joined us as well. Hi, Gabe.
Gabe, what's up?
He said no.
Nope, he said no. You're like, whoops, wrong chat room.
And Ricardo and Kira, while we're kind of working on your drawings, what have you guys noticed the difference between before when you were approaching this as a learner versus now as you're teaching these to other people and other artists?
I'm still learning.
Yeah. I know, but like, I'm just curious to see how it feels now after a couple fundamental classes under your belt. Ricardo, this is your fourth or fifth drawing group as well. And I'm just curious on your perspective there.
don't know. It's been super fun. I mean, it's always been said that you can learn more by teaching than doing, because I've said it a bunch of times, even in my class, that, you know, I'm trying to take fundamentals and, like, I shouldn't say dumb them down, but simplify them even more to explain them to the public so that I can get as many people as possible to understand exactly what I'm trying to implement in a short amount of time. And with that, it's super challenging, but at the same time, I learned so much myself by simplifying them so much, because it just makes it easier even for myself to understand more. And and even doing homeworks and stuff like that, and this last little section I have, I've been doing filigree. And when I first started the section, I was like, man, I haven't done filigree in quite some time as far as practicing it. This is going to be really challenging to keep consistent with actually showing people how to, you know, do it correctly and start doing it. And by the end of it, my last class, I was starting to notice I was getting back into it as far as making pretty nice compositions. So not only it keeps you up to date with what you're teaching, but at the same time, you're just constantly, you know, reviving the skills that you have, and at the same time showing other people what you got.
Show me what you got.
I don't know, Carter, what do you think about this? You know,
I was actually gonna say something pretty similar to that. I mean, I've been saying it this whole time, is that, like, through trying to explain my own process, I've learned so much just by, you know, picking up, like I said, the dictionary or the Google phone. You know what I mean? Like the dictionary and the computer that's in your pocket all the time on your ass. You just pick it up and get off your ass and learn about it. And I've learned so much. I agree with Kira entirely. It's just about doing. When you are afraid or timid of something, just do it as much as you possibly can. Just face it, take it, and just do it.
Just do it.
Who was that? Is that Shia LaBeouf?
Yeah, that's Shia LaBeouf,
right? Yeah.
No, thank you.
Well, it is, right? But yeah, but he did it and he made it like even cooler than what Nike could, right? But no, I agree with Kier. My experience has been an A for effort, an E for effort, or whatever. You know what the funny part is? I can't remember how that was said, because I never really got those anyway. Mine were usually like this vertical line with two horizontal lines next to it that shape this F.
or a zero,
that would be a circle, right? No, yeah. So yeah, I think if that answers your question, Lauren, because that's
definitely. And I'm curious about Bruno as well, because I've hosted several of his art jams, how he feels now as opposed to before. You know, this is a whole new concept, and I know his art jams are structured a little bit differently than a drawing group, but I'm curious his perception now versus before.
Yeah, thanks for the question, Lauren. Yeah, definitely. I think I definitely agree with what Ricardo and Kira are saying, you know, about teaching. Like, it really is a great opportunity to actually learn more about what you know and take it to a deeper level just by trying to explain it to somebody. And I think that every teacher out there, you know, like knows that, you know, like you get to know your process that you're trying to teach even more with every time that you teach it. I've heard great teachers say that. And as far as paint jams, it's been incredible, you know, because it's such an amazing experience to share with so many talented artists while they're naturally going about their own process to create an art piece. And so, you know, it's such a great opportunity to be inspired and to learn new tricks, you know, that you can add to your arsenal by staying open and receiving all this great information that is shared on these paint jams, you know, as far as, their approach, their routines, you know, how they go about the same things that I go about, but like in their own way. And that's always you know, very helpful information, you know, that can help make key adjustments that can make things better for yourself when creating art and in general, you know, when living life. So yeah, you know, it's been a great experience, and I think that you know, just whoever has the opportunity to watch it, you know, like I'm sure that they might feel something similar. There's a lot of knowledge being shared by very, you know, humble and very talented artists.
That's a good way to put it, man.
Yeah, and I guess like the people that do follow the classes regularly, and you can see their progress. It feels nice.
Yeah.
But it's like, oh, well, what I'm saying, actually, I guess it's making sense for something.
Yeah, and thank you guys awesome. For giving us the opportunity for even, you know, being able to say these things and,
yeah.
like, and learn these things too. Because like without you guys, we wouldn't be doing any of this stuff at all. Like all your guys' hard work and everything like that, man. Thank you guys so much. Lauren, I know how much you put into it.
Mm-hmm.
It's awesome.
Sandy's awesome. So did you guys join the exercise last night with Ty?
Yes.
How'd that go for you guys?
Super fun.
Awesome.
Yeah. Super fun.
Yeah.
There's so many people there. It's amazing.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. There's some pretty interesting drawings and stuff like that too. It was awesome. If you get a chance, check it out. You won't be disappointed.
Yeah, you will not.
You won't be disappointed. That's enough there, Rippy. That's enough there, Ricotta.
Ricardinho.
Yeah. Yeah, that's Bruno's term for me. Ricardinho is great. I love it. I showed up to the airport and he's like, Ricardinho. I was like, Bruno, what's up? Pretty sure I heard the angels singing and stuff. And... yeah, exactly. Like, I'm here, man. I made it. There's Bruno right there.
One thing I want to touch on Kira's point of seeing the growth and stuff like that. If anybody's watching and they do have some of their skulls, I'd be really interested to see them within the app or anything like that.
Yeah, that would be a huge pleasure for you guys to share where you're at with this process. What would you say, Bruno? Like, because I think I heard you saying it quite a bit while we were doing this collaborative piece, like with your... using these new tools and stuff like that. What would you say? Would you say that was like the charcoals and the application of like the sponge with the sponge brush and holding the the brush a little bit differently? Mm-hmm. What would you think about that? You would say to anybody that might like, well, how would you express it? How would you say that it's different?
God, I mean, like yeah, every medium is very different, and I think that. It's very likely that some people are gonna accommodate to some to the process of certain mediums more than others. And like I found it to be so much fun to use charcoals, and it does take a while, you know, because like for you to get familiar with your tools and for your tools to start to do what you want them to do, you know, like the first stage, you know, the first couple times that we sat down to do some charcoal. I struggled a lot, man. I felt like I was dumb, you know. I was like, man, I was kind of, you know, getting ready to give up and be like, yeah, man, I don't know, man. I'm not having a good day. But that's just a natural part of the process, you know. Like, there's always a bit of a struggle, especially when you're getting familiar with the tools. But if you insist, like, you know, the more that you practice, you know, the more that you do it, the you know, without you even trying too hard, like, you know, you start to get comfortable with your tools, and then you start to get the results that you were hoping for, and it starts to become more fun, and before you know it, you know, there's another medium that you can explore and have fun with, and so I think it's important to get past that first stage, you know, when you're going outside your comfort zone, trying a new medium, and just kind of persist, and don't get frustrated. I mean, it's gonna happen, but always remember that it's really important to have fun.
It's supposed to be fun.
It's supposed to be fun. Well, you know, why, like Jason was saying, right? Like, question the intention of the situation. And one of the intentions has got to be that it makes you happy. You know,
yeah.
To do it.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes we remember, because you know the mind is that way. It confuses us sometimes. And so it's important to go back to that thought. You know, am I having fun here? Am I like letting my mind just get the best of me? Mm-hmm. And you get past that first age and things get better. But with that said, you know, like I have such a long way to go with it, but I'm having so much fun that I look forward to continuing to practice.
I think it's important to note that every time you try a brand new medium that you've never delved into before, don't do like a crazy project, because you're going to set yourself up for failure. And that's, do just a simple sphere study, like do a simple value study of something, just so you can like understand your relationship with your materials and understanding like what you are holding in your hands. Like, just because, you know, like I know there are some kids that can just ride a bike without training wheels, like around Walmart, just first day bought a bike, but this is different. This is
lucky best.
You're right. this is a trained thing, and you have to retrain yourself with a new medium because now there's new rules. And I felt that way with charcoal at first. Like an immediate difference I noticed was that you can push and pull your values to the most extreme points, from like crazy dark to just super light again with like ease. And I think that's such an amazing thing, but it was definitely, it's new. And then when I showed up here to Florida, they had these sponge stick things here.
Soft pastel brushes.
And to me, I was having a really tough time with it. I was just like, I don't understand how to push these around. I was getting all frustrated. And then next thing you know, I just had another piece of paper up on an easel and I just zoned out. And I was like, all right, let's figure out what this is, what the rules are, and how to manipulate them in a way that can work for me as an artist, not so much anybody else.
That's that magic spot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, dude. When you start.
Mm-hmm, hit that flow state and go.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what I did. I didn't allow myself to get super frustrated or just be like, you know what, charcoals are just not it. Or just, you know, even ask for these guys for help. I just kind of popped a headphone in and I was like, all right, let's see what this is for us as an artist, not so much anybody else, which I think is important when you do any new medium.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say, because I didn't realize like how foreign this might feel to a lot of people and like how that might determine the outcome of your image and such, you know what I mean? So like, that's what I was trying to say. Now I'm trying to say, if you guys have any questions about it, let us know and we can kind of walk you through the process of it, like how to use it, you know what I mean? Because I think last week, when we were doing this particular skull, you know, we were using a lot of the tip of it, remember?
Yeah.
And then I was like, no, let's turn it to the side, let's make it a little bit flatter to the surface, parallel with the surface, and use the blunter edge of it. And it was like a night and day difference. You know what I mean? So like, it's just little techniques like that might kind of distract you from feeling accomplished in it. Like, you know, like what we're saying is,
mm-hmm.
And the overall goal was to kind of teach us about just general shapes, turning them into forms, the mm-hmm. relationships between, you know, light and dark shadows, and how that translates into the perception of a dimension, you know, a dimensional image. So like, if you are getting lost in it, you are having issues with it, let me know, send me a message, reach out to me. I mean, either way, I'll be happy to help you. I'll be happy to see what you got going on. Like Lauren said, send them to us, man. Let's see where we're at. You know, don't be apprehensive about sharing mm-hmm. what you don't think is good just because you're struggling with the media. So like, let's check it out. Let's grow together.
Any critique is best than no critique.
Yes. And you have to put yourself in that place to be able to take that information in too.
And I think it's important to note that all three of us were in that position of like, no, it's, you know, it's okay, but yeah. I don't need to put this out there.
Yeah, exactly.
And then as soon as we did it, you know, it's been just nothing but good intentions the entire time.
Yeah.
Nothing but improvement. And I will say that ever since joining all of these classes that you can get with Reinventing, our skill levels with our artistic, you know, skills and everything have increased and gotten so much better and improved vastly, you know, super fast.
Yeah.
Because like you said, we've only been talking to each other for how long, like 4 months?
Yeah.
And it's like night and day difference from who we were 4 months ago. Yeah. So start today.
Start today. Today is the day.
Check out those fundamentals.
Stop.
Because I think it doesn't matter what medium you're about to get started on. Like, if you haven't really, you know, gotten familiar with some of the fundamentals, you know, like, you're going to struggle and you're going to get more frustrated.
Yeah.
And sometimes,
yeah, start a new medium, but maybe start it, like you were saying, you know, with a sphere, or you know, work on the fundamental of that new medium, because they go hand in hand. Like, you'll run into a wall sooner or later.
Yeah. Them. And I don't know who it was that said this, but it was one of you guys that said that, you know, a lot of art schools don't teach technique so much.
Jason was talking about that.
Yes, and I think it's very true, because, you know, you have an art school and they teach you like, okay, this is this person, this is this medium, but they don't teach you like, okay, you want this effect, you need to do this step-by-step process to get to this end result.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that that's a huge, just part of the definition of fundamentals is just breaking it down to the simplest form, to have your brain understand that simplest form so that you can get yourself to more advanced, you know, degrees of things.
Yeah.
And that's not just with techniques of art, but also with, you know, like, I think philosophy is a huge thing. And I think yourself in the fundamental proper state of mind, as well as with flow state, which is what I talked about last week, is super important to be able to get yourself to relax in these early stages of failure.
well said. Early stages of failure.
Yeah. And I think it was a quote that a famous artist said, I don't know who, don't ask, but he said to fail as quick as possible to get to the improvement that you want to. So that just means don't be scared of it, like I failed, this paper just ripped in half.
Yep.
Like, I just poked a hole through this canvas that I've been working on for 40 hours. Like, like, I just tried this one medium and now it's like too glossy. Like, it's going to happen, but it's just nothing but a learning experience. But you're not going to learn from that experience if you just get mad.
And just crumple it up and throw it away.
Yeah, if you just crumple it up and throw it away and just move on to the next one, you're not actually registering what you just did. And I guarantee you, it's going to happen again 10 minutes later.
Oh yeah, big time.
So, and I'm not speaking like at anybody, this is from my personal experience.
Very good. Yeah,
no, that's just me stating it from an early days of apprenticeships and trying to learn the basic fundamentals. And not gonna lie, it took me like 2.5-3 years just to learn basic fundamentals, because I would just be angry all the time when I wouldn't get it. Like, I'd be doing S curves and filigree for hours over and over and over again, and I would just keep flipping pages, but I wasn't actually sitting there and digesting the moves I was making and the decisions I was making and why it wasn't working. So there's just a vast difference. So I just, that's what I think is super important, because I don't want anybody else to go through that.
You know what the crazy part is, Kier? Like, just last night on the guys in class,
yeah,
we were going over everybody's pictures. He's like, does anybody want to show where we're at this point of the process? And I remember last night I showed him mine, and you know, he gave me a couple quick pointers what he observed to help with this kind of in the background kind of image, how to soften it up in comparison to my foreground. And I applied it and boom, it was just like the night and day difference, you know what I mean? And it's so awesome, because I used to be so intimidated about this idea of meeting these people that I've always looked up to. And Guy Epson ends up being like this super, really cool, down to earth, like approachable guy. Just another person just like all of us, you know what I mean? And like, it's been such an eye-opening experience, and I wouldn't have even recognized that. I wouldn't have even been able to say what I'm saying now unless I wouldn't. I mean, if I would have just stayed off of here, if I wouldn't have like voiced up and said, yeah, let's check it out. Hey, man. I have mine. I think it's getting closer to being done. Let's take a look at it, like you suggested, and see how you feel about it. And you know, depending on what frame of reference you're coming from, you could have taken that as a negative criticism, but it wasn't. He's just trying to be helpful. And I think that's the thing. A lot of it depends on where we're coming from, how we see it. Do you think so?
Yeah. I mean, this is all just part of the artist's journey, you know? Yeah. These are all the it depends what ifs there comes moments, you know?
Right.
It's just because I mean, they're all similarities, because I'm sure all of us, when we first joined the Monday night exercise with Guy, we're all just like, hey, oh my gosh, this is Guy.
Yeah.
We're totally going to have to show our work to.
Yeah.
And B, for me personally, it was, I need to make the best composition of my life to show Guy, because I want to be the best and I know I can be.
So I need to show the best in my work. And it was actually making the opposite effect.
Yep.
Like I was just distributing the worst composition I've ever made in my life to the point where guys like, okay.
Yeah.
Like he was the crumb bunny.
You were the crumb bunny, yeah. Yeah, he's like, all right. So I asked for a horse, but you gave me a crumb bunny. All right. And even then, he still gave me constructive criticism.
Yeah.
Like, well, the hand looks kind of funny here. And oh man, that was hilarious.
Dude. And it wasn't until I stopped trying so hard to make crazy compositions that my skill levels actually started to improve. And he was just like, oh, all right, this is fun.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And like, even in the opposite perspective of that, even when I would turn in something that I thought was the absolute best, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is awesome. Like, for example, that female face that I did, and the class was about hair texture, and I think I'll remember this for the rest of my career. And I turned this in, and I was so hyped. I was like, oh my God, this is so good. Like, this is great. Oh my God, I can't wait for him to see this. And he saw it, and I remember this forever. He said, and I quote, for how well rendered that nose is, the hair is not the best feature.
Yeah.
And then you just hear that cartoon sound of wah, wah. Wah. Wah,
wah, wah. Yeah, that's great, man. Oh, dude, it's awesome.
But all that did was just push me to, I was like, all right, fine. I'll do even better hair next time. And that's just the mental state that needs to happen.
Yeah.
And he didn't obviously say it in a malice way. He said right after, he's like, I'm sorry, I'm just keeping you, you know, on your toes and the best you could be. And I appreciated that more than anything. And I would rather him say something like that, or anybody say something like that, than just be like, yeah, man, this is cool. I like this.
Yeah.
Like, things not going perfect, you know, or things not, you know, turning out great, you know, or I don't want to say failure, right? But things not working out is totally part of the process, natural part of the process. Without that, you can't move forward.
Yeah. And I think it's best to say that when you think that things are going to go the absolute best, they don't. Or like, you know, when you're super prepared for everything is when they go the opposite. So you just have to be prepared for everything, you know, be prepared for the best of the best, but also be prepared for the worst of the worst and be okay with it.
Yeah. So would you say that that's kind of being a little bit more of the mindset of being in the moment?
That's a Wu Wei right there.
Yeah. So you'd say that's some Wu Wei shit.
Yeah.
Are you talking about Wu-Tang or Wu Wei? No, yeah, I agree with you, man. Like, it's better, you know, to kind of just accept it for what it is, and not don't put your personal affliction on it, your personal perspective on it. Like, just take it for what it is. It's constructive criticism.
Yeah, it's, you know, honestly, like, the, you know, one feels really intimidated, afraid, because you want things to work out perfect, everything to go perfect. But you know, like, if you haven't failed yet, then you know you're asking for something unreasonable. And not only that, but like when that moment comes and things don't go the way you want it, it's actually a relief.
Mm-hmm.
You can actually free yourself from that fear you had that you wanted everything to go perfect, because that's it, it's done. Now things didn't go perfect, now you can move on.
Yeah.
And stop focusing on that. And
very well said.
And you just kind of realize that, you know, it's all silliness.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude,
and then, yeah, absolutely. Especially like when you fumble, especially when I fumble in my classes or whatever, when I'm just like,
Yeah, me too.
I completely forgot what I said.
Yeah. Did I just say this? Or does that make sense?
And then that's just the moments when you're just like making jokes about yourself. You're just like, look at me go.
Yeah.
Wrong layer again.
Oh, dude, I hate it. That's so great, man.
Not again. God dang it. But it's not a reflection of who you are or anything. That's just what happens. You're just gonna fail no matter what. And you could be the toppest of dogs and you'll still fail every once in a while. But
not
every day.
Well, you have to have that basis for a comparison and learning, right? That makes
sense. Yes. Yes.
So it's just a natural part of it.
The fundamentals.
If you will.
If you will.
And how.
And way.
Yeah. Wu Wei is the way.
I think we're getting close for this being pretty close. Like, I think I would say it's about 75% done at this point. But I think we're getting a lot nearer a finished skull representation. Let's see what you guys think. Actually, Kira, you know what I was gonna have you guys do, if you wouldn't mind, is like jump in and kind of put some things on it that you might see. Like, I'm really, yes, actually, I would actually love it if you would do that, because
all right,
what I'd really like to do is accomplish this like reflective kind of curve here.
Reflective curve?
Yeah, there's like this curve that makes that shape for the skull. The Terminator line, exactly. Okay. So I need to establish that, and I think it's somewhere around here.
You want me to sit in your spot?
Yes,
you...
I do. Okay. Please. Thank you.
Can I talk about the ambient occlusion?
I would love for you to, actually.
Hello, everybody. All right. I'm Ricardo.
Triangles.
Triangles this, triangles that.
Remember when you guys saw Mandalorian for the first time?
Okay, so we're going to talk about ambient occlusion, I guess. You don't have a reference anymore. That's okay. I don't need a reference. That's fine. Okay, so pretty much what we talk about with an ambient occlusion is the pretty much simplest definition is that anywhere where the light doesn't touch. Best example for that is the light on the bottom of a tire. So you have the tire right underneath it. There's no light whatsoever. It casts that little shadow underneath it. That's ambient occlusion. That's important in tattooing because it'll emphasize depth much better when it comes to tattoo images. Plus, as Jason Laser says, if you don't think you have enough black, then you definitely need to put some more in there. 30% more is what he says. So, with that, since our light's hitting this way, I'm gonna make a little light bulb. That's why I hit my glass. Okay, if light's hitting that way, then we can emphasize the terminator edge right on this side. And don't mind me, because I'm still new at charcoal, so
you're doing great. Doing all this.
You're doing great.
And this isn't my piece, so I'm a little nervous.
I'm nervous. This is a learning experience as well.
We'll use this little thing here. Let's see what we got. Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. Look at that. What do you know?
So your terminator edge, or as best example, in a sphere, that line that contours the sphere to give it its actual form, and that's the terminator line. Okay, your terminator line should not be black, does not exist, okay? It's just one of the darkest values of your form besides absolute black, okay? But your ambient occlusion is your absolute black. So you should really only be putting little small amounts to give it that emphasis, almost, you know, shaping the silhouette of your form, but making sure that it's in the right places. And like you see, if you can see it, like you see up here, I put it underneath here to just make this whole piece pop forward. But I also added it within this background as almost like niches and crevices of where light just will not exist. It just won't. It does not scientifically exist. And with that, with doing that, it'll actually open up your value scale a little more, and it'll give more opportunities for more texture and places where light can go or not go. So that's why I think ambient occlusion is important. Y'all may think differently, but as Ricardo says, you kind of just scumble it in here, right? And as you can see, it's already starting to bring this nose kind of forward a little bit. That's what we want. And you can really see ambient occlusion in skulls as far as in the orifices, in the eyes and nose. And then there's always this little tiny corner on the side of your mouth where no light really kind of touches. But since the light is coming from this side, you'll actually see a little bit. So I'm not going to put anything too crazy in there. But on this side, you definitely can.
So can I ask this here, when you're talking about this ambient occlusion and where the light doesn't hit, does the shape of, does the form, it being either a cylinder or a sphere or a cone, that takes effect, right? Like that applies to the lack of light as far as the shape of the form, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, all it does is that it just solidifies it coming out of the paper.
So, like, I'm going to do this in a corner, okay, Ricardo?
Oh, dude, let's use it.
Okay, so, like, if I had a, you know, sphere here, I don't know how well you guys can see this, but if, you know, that's my highlight here, and here's my terminator edge, right? My ambient occlusion is going to be just this little smudge that's on the bottom. So, that's it.
Okay.
It's not the cast shadow.
Right.
It's this is it, just right here underneath.
Right, the okay? darkest dark.
That's it.
Yep.
So, then it'll make way for when I do make my terminator edge, you know, my terminator edge will automatically be lighter than my ambient occlusion, which will give it even more form and make way for my reflected light being lighter. So it'll make it just a complete utter roundness to it. And if you're not too sure what reflected light is, you know, if I have my light bulb up here, right, and light's coming down, you know, light technically is bouncing off of everything, okay? So if it's bouncing off of the ground, it's going to hit back up on the back of the surface. And that's what creates the form. And that's why the terminator edge has that darkness to it, because that's just that one rim where the reflected light and direct light are kind of having a tough time of hitting. So that's the best way to explain that. But you really just want to use your ambient occlusion just to solidify all the contrast that you're about to bring in your surface here. And it should be used in finite amounts. Don't just like blast the whole thing with ambient occlusion unless, you know, I'm only speaking for tattooing compositions. I'm sure there are ways and rhymes and reasons for a lot of absolute black to go into places.
Yeah, I would say that helps out with like a really powerful light source.
Yes.
Like a directional lighting scenario.
But just be weary, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. Because a lot of black is good, but at the same time, you can overpower it and you won't really get to see a composition or your form around that.
Yeah, so. I agree with you completely. In tattooing, you know, a lot of that stark black fields are really valuable to the longevity of the life of a tattoo and the overall composition, or the overall, what is saturation, the look of saturation as far as colors and things like that, vibrancy, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, but when it comes to your paintings, drawings, etc., you can kind of manipulate that a little bit more.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can really use all fields of terms for, you know, your mid-tone, you know, highlights, center lights, mm-hmm. reflected lights, ambient occlusions. Like that could all be in there in drawing and painting and everything, mm-hmm. or whatever you're doing. But there are certain times in tattooing where actually simplifying it will get you farther. But what could always be there is ambient occlusion, in my opinion.
Now, a question about your technique. I noticed that you jump around quite a bit the way that I do, right? And I've noticed that a lot of other artists do the same thing, but I have seen some artists that will complete an entire field, an entire section of a drawing almost completely before they even move on to the next section.
I actually look up to a lot of artists that do that, mm-hmm. but just to have that patience, just to stick with one area, mm-hmm. because I have major ADHD, everybody. So when I see, when I'm working on one area, I'm immediately looking across the page and I'm like, well, they all need to be on the same layer, you know?
Yeah.
So I guess that's how I could explain it. I work in layers. So, you know, the ambient occlusion is going to be applied as a whole. And then you can go back in there with your reflected light and either, you know, lighten that or darken that to make sense for your composition. And then go into your midtones and then go into your highlights and then your center lights and then repeat the process all over again. But I, even with tattooing, I jump around a whole bunch.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think a lot of artists that I have seen do that, and that I'm not trying to, you know, talk down about anybody's technique or anything like that. And I'm not trying to have this in a negative light whatsoever, but I have noticed that when that application is applied to their technique, it's kind of like the photorealism where you have a strong reference, you know what I mean? Where you are relying heavily on that reference point as far as like replicating that image, because it is a photorealistic tattoo.
Yeah.
Now, would you say that like that's affected? Do you think that affects like the technique?
Even when I've worked on references, like when I was growing up and I didn't have somebody actually teaching me art, all I did was copy Google images. Like I would just look at a reference that I liked and want to redraw the whole thing at like a photocopy. And I was still jumping around like crazy. So I think this is, it's just part of the artist's journey. That's just who you are. Like, are you going to jump around or are you going to, you know, stay in one place and complete it? And at the, it has its own pros and cons, because if you're working, let's say, for example, in color, right, and in tattooing, it's best to jump around. If you're doing like a piece and you have a lot of color, it's best to jump around to let that skin heal and have those colors actually come forward, and you can see how, you know, saturated, unsaturated the area is. So it's best to jump around. And I think that's kind of where it comes from for me, because I love color, so I want the most out of it. So I just jump around. But it's all different. If you don't kind of jump around in one area with for color, it kind of may leave some little holiday areas, or you won't let the skin breathe a little bit, because that does need to happen when you're tattooing, that I've noticed. Kind of the skin kind of reaches a point where it's like, okay, dude, I'm kind of done being messed around with. And then you move on to another section, whether that's done or not. And then, you know, give it another like 10, 20 minutes, come back to it, and it's like perfectly fine. From what I noticed.
No, yeah, I agree. I would agree completely.
So
I agree with that completely.
Jumping around is kind of a person to person thing, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think so too. I think there can be applications for it where you can like really focus, I guess, and start, you know, wanting to change your approach.
Yeah.
You want to change your overall effect, like Jason was talking about earlier.
Well, it's like the process too of, you know,
I was exactly going to point that out.
That's awesome. Exactly what I'm going to point out as well is like my first thing that I do in any composition when I start adding form is I'll immediately put in the Terminator edge, like immediately.
Yeah.
Because then that immediately calms my brain down to understand where the light is coming from. So that way, let's say I stop for the day and I come back to it, I know exactly what's happening. Right. So like if I was just starting this, I'd immediately put this whole section in. And then immediately put this in and immediately do this side. Other people may just start with their midtones and do all the midtones and then put their darkest darks in and then their highlights. Some people start with highlights and then just work backwards. Like it's all different. But it's an understanding of what works best for you. What works best for me is putting in that Terminator edge at a very early stage. And kind of just calming my own brain down to be like, nah, this sucks. Because I, you know, as an artist, and I'm only speaking for myself and my own, you know, experiences, but you are telling yourself the entire time that you're doing any composition or project that this is trash until it's done and you're like, that wasn't so bad.
Right.
So you're just making yourself feel better the entire time until it's done, or until you're like, you know what, dude, I'm done. And you kind of go in there. And I will say, last but not least, putting ambient occlusion, you can actually start adding textures in there.
Yes.
From your ambient occlusion, like I did up here, like start actually adding textures from just applying an ambient occlusion. Because like I said, it's just those little crevasses of where light doesn't touch. So
you can almost make it, that's the joy, I think, of it, in the magic, where the magic is that it really shows that illusion that we create, because those are entirely suggestive shapes.
Yeah.
But our brain ties into what we recognize and what we've been taught, or what we know as what the shape really is.
Yeah, it's like definitely.
When you're looking at a room in the dark at night, you know exactly where all your furniture is, but your imagination starts taking a hold, and you can you can see whatever you want to see.
And now my hamper looks like a goblin, and I'm scared.
Yeah, exactly.
So it definitely makes sense, and I think ambient occlusion, I think I don't know, I'm a huge fan of my dark families. Like I give them a lot of credit, because when you apply your dark families, that's kind of it. Like everything else is kind of speaks for itself in the sense. And so putting in your ambient occlusion in your Terminator is brilliant. And especially when you're doing tattoos, because people really see those like darkest points and they're like, wow, that's solid. That's there. That's, as you know, Ricardo was saying yesterday at breakfast, you could really reach in there and grab it. And that comes from your Terminator and your reflected light and your ambient occlusion. That's your darkest family. That's it. but I think this is okay for now. So I just made it like pop out a little more.
Yep. No, it is exactly what it is that you were talking about doing too, which is that you've established that contour and shape, right? Because it's not a line work, it's not an edge. You've established that contour abstract shape.
Yeah, and
there's those little nuances in relation to value as far as the scale from dark being or black being your darkest to white being your lightest.
Yeah, and then as soon as you put those in, all of your other values start to lighten up. It's like magic almost. Yes. Because yes. As soon as you add a much darker, like black in there, all of the values that you thought were your darkest darks are now like almost mid-tones. Mm-hmm.
It also happens when you do that on the background too.
Yeah.
You know, bring out the foreground piece and make the colors almost look lighter.
Yeah, you can definitely do that, adding a darker background, like Bruno said, and establishing your value here. Thank you, Bruno. And that's really going to separate your values as well, because that's what I see a lot, is that people will put like mid-tones in there in their darkest darks, and they'll be like, oh my gosh, why does this look so bland and soft? And that's just because you're not establishing your darkest darks, and then that'll transfer all of the values to their necessary mark here. And then when you start doing that, you can actually see little textured nuances that happen, and you can really play with them. I like this. This is nice.
Bruno, you want
to add some stuff to it?
Come
on down, Bruno. Yeah. What's that Price is Right thing where everything gets called down and they're just like,
Come on down.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, it's looking really good.
Yeah.
See the light. The light's coming from this direction for sure.
Light bulb.
Yeah.
Uh huh.
Something this way.
This is what collabing is, guys. This is.
Yeah.
This is what friends are for.
Yeah. The alternator has definitely established a lot of depth here.
Yeah.
The coolest part is that what a life it's taken on its own. You know what I mean? Like by you and I and Bruno working on it together, all three of us, it's almost like its own entity. It's like neither one of us really drew it.
Yeah, I think that's the coolest part about this whole thing is like even when I showed up at your place, Ricardo, for the first time, immediately off the plane, what did we do?
Yeah, we started drawing.
We started drawing immediately. And then as soon as I got off the plane here, what did we do? We started drawing. Like. It was like midnight, almost 1 a.m, and I came over to this and I was like, hey, can I like touch it? I'm seeing some stuff here.
Yeah.
I think you can use some ambient occlusion on here.
Yeah.
Ambient a what?
Ambient occlusion.
That's
yes.
There you go. And that's the reason I point that out is because it's, you know, it's that next step. If you guys are feeling like you're kind of, you know, stuck in a spot with your art, or with your ideas, your concepts, their technique. I mean, it's always good to reach out and talk to people like with the same interests as you. It's very helpful. It helped me out tremendously. I was in literal funk for such a long time before I met you guys, and this has been awesome.
Yeah, we always talk about it all the time, how we first met and how it's been such a journey thus far. I think it's fantastic. And y'all can do this too. You just, you know, band together. Start making different groups, other horsemen, other stables.
Other stables. Stay consistent, you know, with your practice. Maybe develop like a routine where you continuously allow yourself some time to practice and some exercise.
Account.
Yep. Okay.
Yeah. So, man, there's been a lot of information that we've kind of thrown you guys' way today. But
I'm sorry.
No, it's good. I think it's so awesome that we get a chance to do this together. Yesterday, I think that was the case for us. We went to Wynwood Park, Wynwood Block. The Wynwood Walls yesterday down here in Miami, Florida. If you guys are ever in this area, make sure and go and check that place out because it was jaw-dropping.
It was a dream. It felt like a big dream.
They took like an old dilapidated kind of neighborhood space right from them, and they kind of turned it into like an outside gallery.
Yeah, like many years ago, the properties around here were very cheap. So artists started renting big art, big spaces to create art. And that started to accumulate, and then it kind of turned into like an art district, and where like gallery showings happening, and then it was noticed, and then it just blew up and became what it is, which is it's an awesome place. It's very inspiring to be there.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. They have like a lot of them spray painted these sections of wall, and there's some really well-known artists on there. There's a piece by Ron English down there. There's a piece by
Audrey Kawasaki,
and there's a few other, like, and I can't even recall their names. And then there's a few graffiti groups that were doing a bunch of amazing pieces down there too.
Tatunga had a really cool mural as well.
Yeah. And then we ended up walking down the street trying to find where we parked. I think we were all in kind of this daze because we were just staring at these pieces, and it was amazing. And we tried to find the car, ended up walking down the wrong direction for a second, which, a lot of people would have been like, we're lost. Where are we going? What the hell? We're all grumpy, but we just made the best of it. Found this really cool restaurant. Turns out to be the exact spot Bruno was looking for. But what happened is that the old restaurant there closed down and turned into a different place.
Yeah, it happened by accident. Because Ricardo was like, I don't know, guys, like, what about this place?
Yeah.
And I'm like, all right, let's go to this place. And then Bruno was like looking around.
Wait a minute.
Yeah. This is the place.
Yeah. And it was so radical, too, because we had some really good food. We had a couple really good, we had some decent drinks.
Stop.
Bruno,
guys.
And I had a couple. Cheers, yours wasn't really that great.
Yeah, we were a little sad here.
I drank a good majority of it.
Tasted like soup.
Yeah, it tasted like soup.
It was
some off tomato soup.
It was tomato soup, but it was
nice and warm.
Yeah, and so then we ended up getting some good food. Bruno went, went to the bathroom. We got pulled into like a little dance party they had going on back there.
Hey.
Because Bruno said that he could do salsa a little too loud.
I think they heard me. We had a good time, man. So if you guys ever get a chance, you want to come down here, go check out that place.
Wynwood.
And just,
Design District.
I think the biggest point of it is just to make your own art friends, man.
Yeah.
Make your friend, like, that's what it is. That's what makes all of this art stuff super fun.
Yeah.
Is that you could get to come down, show up at 1 a.m. and still work until like almost 3.
Yeah. And then wake up 3 or 4 hours later and do it all over again.
And it's like you just make memories with friends and share all your information and be open to new information. And that's really it. This is the artist's journey.
It's the intentions, right, that we have in common. Like, going back to what Jason was saying earlier, like, we just want to keep, going deeper and deeper into the subject and into like the, all these things that can potentially make your art better, and we can't get enough. And so, we have shared these days and we've been creating art. Now, last night we were till like 3 a.m. Mm-hmm. Putting our minds together for a collaboration project, a tattoo collab we're starting tomorrow. And so things are happening, just because we got together with a similar intention, so it's really cool. Like they said,
Friends
and friends that have a similar.
Yeah. And you can always, I don't even mean like just tattoo artists. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like make friends with all artists, like graphic designers and marketers and
hairstylists.
I learned a lot of my color theory from hairstylists, that just because the color theory, as far as mixing colors, is almost very similar. and they have similar reactions to the hair as they do with the skin as far as oxidation goes. Yes.
Oxidation, yeah.
So I just ask all the questions and you know, be open to them and make all the friends I can in the same realm of artisticness that it is. Because Bruno's really into biomech and like psychedelic abstracts, and Ricardo's very much illustrative realism, and Jason's Japanese, and then Larry's traditional, but we still all help each other out in very similar ways. And I think that's super important. Gotta have variety.
Gotta have a variety.
Whole swirl of variety.
And it's always good for you guys. We're not trying to exclude anybody or, you know, keep anybody out. If you guys want to reach out, just reach out to us, man.
Yeah, man.
Always willing and happy to talk to people.
Community in general.
I'm not scary.
No.
I'm 5'1".
Does that mean you're not scary because you're 5'1"?
I don't know. Chihuahuas are pretty terrifying.
They are.
If small dogs are quite scary compared to larger ones. So, I don't know. I like that when Bruno sat down, he immediately attached the lights.
Yep. I like that too. It's really bringing out another layer of light to it.
Mm-hmm. Really worked on that reflected light. Bruno, proud of you. Making that reflected light lighter than that mid-tone. I love it.
How does the saying go, Kier?
Light is dark. It's darker than the darkest light. But that's confusing.
Wrap your head around that one, would ya?
Would ya?
Say it again. Say it again in slow motion.
The light is dark. It's darker than the darkest light.
This side's the dark side. Don't go to the dark side.
All it means is that your mid-tone is darker than your reflected light. Isn't that much easier? Why does that have to be confusing?
That's what we're doing here.
Mm-hmm. You know what I thought of that actually helped me out a lot too, not so much thought of, but learned?
Mm.
Is the 80-20 rule. You guys heard of that?
No.
So like what 80% or sorry, what 20% of effort will bring 80% of my happiness?
Yes, I have heard that one actually. Yeah.
Hmm.
It's a good one.
Yeah.
So like it just pretty much means that you don't put less effort in to make yourself happy. That's not it. But like for example, in my early years, well, I'm still in my early years, but like last year. A few days ago. Before I got really into tattooing and everything, as far as licensing goes, I was sending a lot of prints to just artists that I looked up to. And it really took no effort at all, but I just messaged them on Instagram and I was like, hey man, I'm really inspired by you. Can I just like send you some stuff that's mine, like stickers and whatnot? And 95% of the time, they're like, oh, absolutely. And now, 3 days later, no, but like more like now, you know, a year and a half, 2 years later, I still talk to them on a regular basis, just, you know, asking them questions and asking them how they do certain things. And that brought 80% more of my happiness just from that 20% of effort of just sending them stuff. Make sense?
Yes, it does.
Isn't that crazy?
It's awesome. It's super radical.
Huh.
So I thought that was a cool method of living that I wanted to share. Hope it resonated and or made sense.
It does.
It does. Good.
Absolutely.
Because you're not supposed to stress yourself out to death with this. Especially nowadays with the amount of resources that artists have. Come on. No stress. No stressing. Bruno, you brought this to life. Good job, buddy.
You did, man. Let's kill him.
Come on.
I'll give you that $20 later, Kia.
Slip it together the table.
That looks awesome, dude. It's a thing on life of its own once we all jump in.
Yeah.
I love it. I think it's it's my favorite. It's my favorite.
You haven't been in your lot from your process, Dave.
I can't wait.
Yeah, thank you. I'm glad it resonates. I'm glad it, you know, makes some sense.
Okay, back to you now. Cool.
Can I tell everybody who you are, Bruno?
Yeah. Oh. Say hello.
Yeah, well, I'm Bruno Salvatierra. You can always reach me on Instagram if you have any questions about anything.
Where do they reach you at?
On Prismas_art, PRISMAS_art, Prismas. And yeah, you know, just continue having fun out there. And I strongly recommend joining these drawing groups because not only are amazing people involved and with joy, you know, they're looking to share this information and continue learning along with you guys. But also because, you know, there's so much to learn. There's so much key information and with some consistency of, you know, showing up to these drawing groups and to the subscribers. If you can, the subscribers, drawing group on Monday with Guy Atchison, you're really going to start to see results and it's going to bring you a lot of joy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wait, are we?
You ever sign off?
Okay. Hi, I'm Kim Franklin. I do the Thursday morning at 10 a.m. Eastern Time fundamental classes. If you liked my little tidbit about ambient occlusion, I have a full episode on it on the exercises in the Reinventing Tattoo app, and I have a couple of YouTube ones too, so I think you can find the same one on YouTube, but I'm advertising Reinventing, so go there, because yes. You can find me at Frankie Says Things on Instagram. I am out of Western Massachusetts in Amherst, Mass, if you want to get a tattoo by me, if you're in the area. Then do it. I just got this new shop. It's been wicked cool. I love this shop very much. And I want to show all my clients how cool it is. So definitely come down and hang out. Join me on Thursdays. I'll also be on Mondays as well with the rest of everybody behind me, plus Jason. And join that. Yeah, this has been fun. I feel awake now. And then here's your host.
Yeah. Well, Cardinho. Thank you guys for joining us. Thank you, Kier. Thank you, Bruno. Bruno, it's been awesome being down here, man. I can't tell you how much I appreciate your hospitality and all the knowledge that you're helping me obtain, man. It's a great time. And just getting to meet you guys both in person. Bruno, it's finally awesome to meet you in person, man. So,
same here, man.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for coming.
Yeah. And thank you, everybody, for tuning in. I think this is going to be about it for the skull stuff. I'm always doing skull stuff, so I might do some more, but yeah, there you go. Boom. That turned out killer.
Yeah. Awesome. I want to say thank you to all three of you for working on this together. It's definitely been a great episode. We do have people commenting saying this was such a cool episode that you guys put together. So from all of us at Reinventing, thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Lauren. Appreciate you.
Thank you, guys. Reinventing.